I'm reading today from the Christian Archetype, a Jungian commentary on the life of Christ by Edward F. Edinger. I'm reading chapter 10, Crucifixion. The reality of evil and its incompatibility with good cleave the opposites asunder and lead inexorably to the crucifixion and suspension of everything that lives. Since the soul is by nature Christian, this result is bound to come as infallibly as it did in the life of Jesus. We all have to be crucified with Christ, i.e., suspended in a moral suffering equivalent to veritable crucifixion. That's a quote from the Collected Works of C.G. Jung, volume 12, paragraph 24. This is a medieval Spanish image of the crucifixion, and I'll read the scripture. And when they were come unto a place called Golgotha, that is to say, a place of a skull, they gave him vinegar to drink, mingled with gall. And when he had tasted thereof, he would not drink. And they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet. They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots. And sitting down, they watched him there, and set up over his head his accusation written, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then were there two thieves crucified with him, one on the right hand and another on the left. Matthew 27:33-38. Now, there are several other images of the crucifixion here. I'm going to spare you of those. The crucifixion is the central image of the Western psyche. The death of Christ on the cross is the central image in Christian art and the visual focus of Christian contemplation. The character of the image varied from one age to another, reflecting the prevailing climate of religious thought and feeling. The early church avoided the subject. At the time when Christianity was a proscribed religion under the Romans, the crucifixion was represented symbolically by the Lamb of Christ juxtaposed with a cross. Even after the age of Constantine the Great, when Christians were allowed to practice their religion without interference, the cross itself was still represented without the figure of Christ. The image of the crucifixion as we know it is first found in the 6th century, but is rarer until the Carolingian era, when representations multiplied in ivories, metalwork, and manuscripts. At this period, there are regularly found those other figures from the Gospels which were to become a permanent feature of the crucifixion. The Virgin Mary and St. John the Evangelist, the centurion and the sponge bearer, the two thieves, the soldiers casting lots, also seen from this time on either side of the cross, are the symbolic sun and moon and the allegorical figures representing the church and synagogue. These latter features were, however, to die out early in the Renaissance. For many centuries, the West, under Byzantine influence, represented Christ himself alive and open-eyed, a triumphant savior wearing a royal crown. In the 11th century, there appeared a new type, the emaciated figure with his head fallen on one shoulder and later wearing the crown of thorns. This version prevailed in Western art thereafter. Collective consciousness has thus altered its relation to this image through the centuries. Initially, it is expressed in an archetypal, impersonal way with no indication of human suffering. The personal and human aspect increases up to the Reformation, at which time Protestant iconoclasm removes the figure of Christ from the cross entirely, signifying the victory of rationalistic abstraction. The crucifixion pictures the juxtaposition of opposites. It is the moment of intersection between the human and the divine. Ego and self are superimposed. The human figure representing the ego is nailed to the mandala cross representing the self. Around the cross, various pairs of opposites are constellated. For instance, on either side of Christ, two thieves are crucified. One goes to heaven, the other to hell. This triple crucifixion hints at the idea, only now thinkable, that Christ is uniting himself with his opposite, the Antichrist. Quote, although the attributes of Christ, consubstantiality with the Father, co-eternity, filiation, parthenogenesis, crucifixion, lamb sacrificed between opposites, one divided into many, etc., undoubtedly mark him out as an embodiment of the self. Looked at from the psychological angle, he corresponds to only one half of the archetype. The other half appears in the Antichrist. The latter is just as much a manifestation of the self, except that he consists of its dark aspect. Both are Christian symbols, and they have the same meaning as the image of the Savior crucified between two thieves. This great symbol tells us that the progressive development and differentiation of consciousness leads to an ever more menacing awareness of the conflict and involves nothing less than a crucifixion of the ego, its agonizing suspension between irreconcilable opposites. That quote is from Ion, Collected Works 9:2, paragraph 79. Quote, through the Christ crucified between the two thieves, man gradually attained knowledge of his shadow and its duality. This duality had already been anticipated by the double meaning of the serpent. Just as the serpent stands for the power that heals as well as corrupts, so one of the thieves is destined upwards and the other downwards. And so likewise, the shadow is on one side regrettable and reprehensible weakness, on the other side healthy instinctivity and the prerequisite for higher consciousness. Collected Work 18, paragraph 210. Other pairs of opposites that gather around the cross include the lance bearer and the sponge bearer, and even the sun and the moon. The crucifixion is clearly a conjunctio and thus manifests the phenomenology of that symbolism. In ecclesiastical art, there has been a definite tendency to turn the image of the crucifixion into a mandala. In a remarkable figure of speech, Augustine equates the crucifixion with the conjunctio. Quote, like a bridegroom, Christ went forth from his chamber. He went out with a presage of his nuptials into the field of the world. He came to the marriage bed of the cross, and there in mounting it, he consummated his marriage. And when he perceived the size of the creature, he lovingly gave himself up to the torment in the place of his bride. And he joined the woman to himself forever. Unquote. That quote is from Mysterium Conjunctionis, paragraph 25, note 176, also paragraph 508. The product of the conjunctio is the self represented by the anthropos, the whole man. Adam symbolizes the first anthropos and Christ the second. This relationship is indicated by the legendary idea that the cross was a tree growing out of the grave of Adam. This tree is said to have grown from a branch of the tree of life, in some versions, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Another image of the reborn self appears in the sign of four letters, I-N-R-I, which is attached to the cross in conventional representations. These letters stand for Jesu Nazarenus Rex Judaeorum. In effect, they constitute a new tetragrammaton. In the Old Testament, Yahweh's name was never vocalized and appeared only as the four consonants, YHWH, Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh. Significantly, this is a quaternity, which is at the same time a triad, since one of the letters is duplicated. The dilemma of the three and four. The new tetragrammation repeats this dilemma and demonstrates again the basic uniformities of the objective psyche. There's a footnote. Three are here, but where is the fourth? Is an important theme in alchemy. Psychologically, it refers to the inordinate difficulty of assimilating the fourth inferior function and thus achieving wholeness. Also, as Jung points out, four signifies the feminine, motherly, physical, three the masculine, fatherly, spiritual. Thus, the uncertainty as to three or four amounts to a wavering between the spiritual and the physical. A striking example of how every human truth is a last truth, but one. That quote is from Collected Works 12, paragraph 31. In the early theology, the cross of Christ was considered to be the instrument that unified the universe. Paul says, quote, "He, Christ, is the peace between us and has made the two, Jew and Gentile, into one and broken down the barrier, phragmos, which used to keep them apart. This was to create one single new man in himself out of the two of them, and by restoring peace through the cross, to unite them both in a single body and reconcile them with God." Ephesians 2, 14 to 16, the Jerusalem Bible. Jean Danielou comments, quote, "Paul's text, in fact, assumes a double phragmos. In the first place, there is one that separates the two peoples, but there is also the phragmos separating the world below from the world above. This was a stock conception. Among the Mandeans, it represents the heavenly wall separating the world below from the Pleroma. The apocryphal Acts also have it, in this sense, conceived as a wall of fire. In this view, Christ restores unity in a twofold sense. He destroys both the vertical wall which separates the two peoples and the horizontal one which separates man from God. And he does this by the cross, which now seems to represent the double operation of Christ extending both vertically and horizontally to form a cross. These are also, in a sense, two crosses, the cross of separation, which existed before the coming of Christ, and the cross of unification, which is the coming of Christ." Unquote. The two crosses refer to the twofold aspect of mandala symbolism. In its simplest form, the cross within a circle, the mandala functions as the crosshairs of a telescope to order and discriminate different areas in the field of view. On the other hand, it also unites all its embraces in a comprehensive whole. The Gnostics also speak of the twofold nature of the cross. The cross, whom we call by a variety of names, has two faculties, the one of supporting and the other of separating. And insofar as he supports and sustains, he is staros, cross. While insofar as he divides and separates, he is horos, limit. They then represent the Savior as having indicated this twofold faculty. First, the sustaining power, when he said, "Whosoever doth not bear his cross, staros, and follow me cannot be my disciple," Luke 14, 27. And again, "Taking up the cross, follow me," Matthew 10, 21. But the separating power, when he said, "I came not to send peace, but a sword," Matthew 10, 34. And Jung states, quote, "The apotropaic significance of the quaternity is borne out by Ezekiel 9, 4, where the prophet, at the behest of the Lord, sets a cross on the foreheads of the righteous to protect them from punishment. It is evidently the sign of God, who himself has the attribute of quaternity. The cross is the mark of his proteges. As attributes of God and also symbols in their own right, the quaternity and the cross signify wholeness." And that's from Collected Works 13, paragraph 363. And that's from an essay entitled The Philosophical Tree, Collected Works 13, paragraph 363. That's the end of chapter 10.